Article 216 of the Constitution is where we find, or we anchor this whole policy, that requires that the Commission defines or determines who is marginalized, and in that regard talks about marginalized areas, and number two, come up with a criteria which sets out how will the equalization fund be shared among those who the Commission identifies. Second, so to bring life to that mandate, the first Commission published the first policy in the year 2013. And in that policy, they allocated 12.4 billion shillings to be implemented through specific projects that were identified. That policy is still ongoing. There was a bit of a slow start, and the projects will continue even as we craft this second policy to the point where those projects are completed. Secondly, Article 204 of the Constitution is the one that established the Equalization Fund, which is a national level fund meant to improve access to roads, water, health, electricity, among others. And once the Commission completes the policy, the Equalization Fund Advisory Board is the one that then takes it over, goes out into the field, works with communities to identify the specific projects that will be implemented during the term of the policy. The Equalization Fund Advisory Board is actually seated at the Treasury. The chairperson of that board is the PS Treasury, and we're expecting them to join us today. And the other members of that board are the principal secretaries in the areas that are identified for funding in the fund. That is the PS in roads, the PS in water, the PS in health, the PS devolution and treasury. So everywhere where the line ministry has a project, that principal secretary sits in the advisory board. And again, it's a national level fund. That is why it is currently implemented through line ministries. So the work of the commission ends at the point where we craft the policy, allocate the funding, we hand it over to the board to implement projects. And like I said, the Constitution is very clear that 0.5% of the last audited and approved revenues will be used to share, will be allocated into the fund, and that is what we shall be allocating in the next policy. And currently, 0.5% of the 13-14 audited account is about 4.68 billion, which is what has been going into the equalization fund. So in the second policy, we'll be allocating the balance. The money that was never appropriated in the first policy, through the first policy, the allocations through 2011-12, 12-13, 13-14, then 17-18, and 18-19. So what will be appropriated will start with the monies that were actually put in the equalization fund but not yet appropriated. So as a commission, we set out on one, an exploratory journey where we really wanted to listen to communities just telling us their story. You have heard a lot of that from the video. Number two, we also wanted to see what data tells us, because you can never argue with data. So we worked with the Kenyan Bureau of Statistics using the last official data that exists. And the first question we asked them, what is the lowest unit of analysis? Or at what lowest level administration can we get data on access to health, access to education, access to electricity, and to extent possible, even on road? We visited other areas where the boreholes had been dug, but because sufficient geological studies were not done, the boreholes have dried up. So it's a mixed story, but a story I'm sure we're all familiar with. How mothers and girls, particularly mothers and girls, take a lot of time fetching water instead of engaging in more productive activities. And as you can see, it's not clean water, it's water that is shared with animals, but that's what they have to do with. We listen to the story about roads. And as you can see, even where they've been able to do some roads, they get washed away over the seasons. And you can tell from the state of that road, it's going to, to require a lot of capital investments to actually do a road in these areas that are, can withstand the different times and seasons, and particularly when you have France to happen, as is the case here. So we then looked at the story of education. Again, this, the status of the infrastructure there is not new. But one of the challenges, which was very common among nomadic pastoralist communities, is that the students are very few, because when parents move in search of water and pasture, then they don't have critical numbers to qualify even to register at the examination centers. So this is the status of a lot of the schools that we visited. This was one of the schools where they were fortunate to have enough teachers. In most of other places, the schools are there, but the teachers are not there. Fortunately, in some areas, CDF has constructed some facilities, but we did come across schools where learning does not happen because communities from other areas are not willing to teach in these very remote locations where security is not guaranteed. So this was very common. So the point is that security will continue being a challenge even as we try to tackle marginalization and provide some of these facilities. So nomadic pastoralism posed significant challenges in tackling marginalization. In one of those places, mothers were telling us there's a place they call the bush maternity, because by the time you get going to Riba, try to get to the first facility, you actually can't get to a facility which is several kilometers away. So what you see here is an example of one such bush maternity, which we visited in Baringo. This is where mothers deliver and recuperate before they go back home. In other places, you see one of our teams visited Turkana, and what you see, this is one of the wards in a hospital in Turkana, and you can see you have patients in one ward, regardless of gender, regardless of whatever ailments they're suffering, but that is the status of the health facilities in most of the places that we visited. So we put all this together in the index and learned from the worst to the best. So we had a robust discussion in the commission and agreed that we cut it off at the bottom 20% and attempt to tackle extreme marginalized areas. Based on 2009 population, this is where 5.6 million Kenyans live. These are the ones we call in the bottom 20%. They're spread along 111 constituencies, and they're actually in 366 wards. Because one of the things that everyone wanted to know, why are you using sub-locations? Yet the new constitutional dispensation has different definitions. So we agreed that after we identify at sub-location level, we can then aggregate to ward level. So although we have 1,424 sub-locations, we actually agree that for the purposes of implementation, this can be done at the ward level, which then reduces to 366. And in some cases where we identify, for example, just one sub-location, we have one sub-location in Transoia, one sub-location in Rwanda, this will only get about 4 million shillings, while the bulk of the money sits in the Reunion 14. Again, the responsibility or the mandate of implementing, identifying the projects and implementing them lies with the Equalization Fund and Voice Report, which is chaired by the PS Treasury. So today we'll hand over this policy to the Equalization Fund Board, who will then come up with the priorities for funding. So that is the happy view of the Commission, that if we could just focus on these three basic services, it would really make a difference. And again, there are other national funds. In the case of electricity, some places, yes, they say electricity is a priority. But the prayer of the Commission is that because there are other national government funds, like the last mile project, this could actually supplement and complement what the Equalization Fund does. And again, in line with the vision of the Commission, it is our humble view that if this is dedicated for the next 5 years, no Kenyan will be left behind. Thank you very much.